Today, amongst other things, I'll explain to you how SpaceX might be able to move Starships to the sea launch platform and when we might expect that highly anticipated flight of Starship Serial Number 8.
What about it? Go for launch.
We're go for launch. Looks like it's handled.
Ignition sequence start.
My name is Felix, and I am your host for today's episode of What About It? And as always, there has been a lot going on in the space industry lately, so let's dive right in. Starship updates. Hello, Y family. First of all, I'm very sorry for missing the Friday update on such a short notice. Short version, my editing PC broke down. For these occasions, it's always good to follow me on Twitter. Information flow is a bit faster there, and so I can keep you in the loop of what's happening in the Y studios. We're back on track though, so let's take a look at when we might finally see the SpaceX Starship Serial Number 8 flight, and what else has happened in the space industry lately. Mauricio from RGV Aerial Photography did another one of his famous flights over the SpaceX Starship construction site and launch site. I cannot emphasize enough how important this is for everyone interested in what exactly SpaceX is doing down in Boca Chica, Texas with their Starship program. If you have the time and funds, head on over to his Patreon and become a flight supporter. Thank you. So it's been quiet for the last few days. Anticipation is very high on the Starship Serial Number 8 flight. And no matter how it turns out, it will be a huge milestone for SpaceX. Everything we've seen fly so far was to a maximum height of 150 meters, and all the prototypes that took flight were either like Starhopper, a demonstrator for Raptor engines, or like Starship Serial Number 5 and 6, tank sections without anything else. This time it's all about a fully assembled Starship. This time it's about 15 kilometers, and this time it's about a full flight, including a skydive, a belly flop maneuver, and a proper landing. And this is what we're looking at, a fully functional Starship prototype. It's still missing a few things crucial for an orbital flight. A heat shield covering one entire half of the hull, protecting it from the heat during re-entry. Starship Legs V2.0, as Elon Musk calls them, an updated version of the Starship legs needed to give the returning spacecraft a more stable stand for safer landings. Much wider and taller, like Falcon, but capable of landing on unimproved surfaces and capable of auto-leveling. Nick Henning and Eric did a speculation for What About It, showing a few possible solutions for Elon Musk's description of what they will have to do. Radically different than the current design, they will have to provide a safe landing not only on Earth, but also on Mars and possibly even the Moon. There is a possibility that SpaceX will go with different leg designs for different tasks. One more aspect where Starships could be designed in a modular way, to be able to quickly adapt to new scenarios. There's still a lot of detail work to be done. Regarding super heavy legs though, Elon Musk still seems to be pursuing the idea of landing the booster so precise that it does not need legs at all. SpaceX wants to achieve the goal of landing the booster directly on the launch mount, ready for refueling. It will require extreme precision and have no margin for error, but it would speed up relaunch times immensely. And it would be totally insane. The first flight of Starship will give SpaceX a lot of data about previously untested systems. The flaps supposed to control the flight path of a skydiving Starship have never been tested in real-life conditions. I fully expect SpaceX to make a few more changes to them before the final version is fully developed. Starship Serial Number 8 is a rough-cut spacecraft, untested with a high chance of failure. Still though, the test has to be done this way. There is nothing SpaceX could draw data from. Nothing can really be compared to their version of a fully reusable rocket capable of launching up to 100 tons of cargo to low Earth orbit on a price tag of $10 per kilogram. What you see in this picture is the current test stand area with pads A and B. And we're right now witnessing the vanishing of the famous dirt hill where everything started. Concrete is covering almost everything now. Stairs, railings, lots of open space. Even the container wall, by the way a very smart move from SpaceX, is properly being integrated. Lots of small workshops and storage space. The launch control center now has air conditioning on the roof. Internal work is progressing more and more. Looking at the launch site from this perspective makes the contrast between old and new visible. On the bottom we have the final facility. This will still be here in 50 years. On top we have the tank farm, still sitting on the dirt foundation. The tank farm is the only old component from the early phase 2 development still remaining. Updated countless times and rearranged over and over again, it looks as experimental as the vehicles that were tested with it. At some point, SpaceX will update it as they did with everything else. Maybe the most important reason for the update not having happened yet would be that this would take quite some time and that SpaceX would not be able to test during the update. Since SpaceX is progressing so fast though, there just might not be any time windows right now big enough to do the job. And there's a new concrete pad right between the two test pads. It's almost finished and should soon be ready for use. There are multiple possible use cases for it. A foundation for a crane to be able to lift starships and super heavy boosters onto the test stand, for example. And all around the center of the launch site, pipes can be found laying around right now. Some insulated thicker pipes and some thinner ones. SpaceX is laying down a pipe raceway from the tank farm all the way to the orbital launch mount. And the launch site is changing for one purpose only. Super heavy and orbital starship flights. The requirements for these kinds of tests are wildly different. Wide roads surrounding landing pad and orbital launch mount, wide enough for a 70 meter tall booster rocket to be moved around. Looking at a map of the area, one thing becomes clear. There is not that much room for exclusion zones around the launch site. A maximum of 5 miles or 8 kilometers without larger evacuation would be possible. Everything further away would be well within the range of South Padre Island, a nearby recreational island with lots of hotels and infrastructure. Musk said that the first few flights will be out of Boca Chica. He never specified though if these flights are just the first few tests or if he's actually talking about full-spec Super Heavy launches including starships and to orbit. Exclusion zones would definitely be a problem. The other alternative would be to go with a sea launch platform. Discussed on the channel before, such a platform out on the Gulf of Mexico would solve the exclusion zone problem, but it would pose new challenges as well. How do you get a Super Heavy and a Starship out to the sea launch platform from Boca Chica? How do you transfer the rocket between the build site and the platform? There are two obvious ways. One option would be to fly to the sea launch platform. As strange as it might sound, with a reusable rocket, you can do that. Just put it on the launch mount in Boca Chica, take off and fly it out to the sea, where it lands and prepares for its next launch. Or you could transfer it by truck and boat. This is the general area of Brownsville and Boca Chica in South Texas. The SpaceX facilities are located here on the coast, with both construction site and launch site visible in an early stage on the map. And all the way back here, connected with the sea through the Brownsville Ship Channel, we have Brownsville Harbor. And this would likely be where SpaceX would get the easiest connection between the construction site and the sea, even though they are right next to it. Building a harbor in Boca Chica would be a massive undertaking which would likely take years to finish if it's even permitted in the first place. Now, Mauricio from RGV took some very interesting pictures on his last flight that I'd like to show you today. This is a picture of the Brownsville Harbor and it shows some storage tanks and more importantly, just below it, a new road construction. And this is a pretty wide road, much wider than anything in the area. SpaceX has been planning this road for a while now, together with the Brownsville Navigation District Office. It's called the Southport Connector Road and will provide a link between the port and Highway 4. It will feature two bridges, will link the port from Ostars Road to Highway 4 about 14 miles west of the SpaceX facility, and the estimated build time is 9 months. So if this is it, they've already started. Here's another view through Google Maps showing the area and the already started part of the road. If it continues down, it hits Highway 4 and from there to the east is Boca Chica. It won't be easy for SpaceX to even transport the starships and super heavy boosters as I am fairly sure that at least right now a starship would collapse under its own weight if it was laid down for transport, but its internal structure could either be improved or SpaceX could transport them in an upright position, as they already do. Meanwhile, at the construction site, SpaceX workers are busy feeding the prototype supply with more and more starships. Like the episode so far? Then make sure to subscribe, hit the like button, and consider becoming a patron to give some vital support. Your support makes all this possible in the first place. And if you want to show the world that you're a fan of What About It and Rockets, check out our merch store and dress differently. It's full of designs made to fill your closets and drawers with awesome shirts, hoodies, zippers, jackets, space caps, cups, bags, you get the idea. Every sale supports the channel, links are in the description. You rock. This is the midbay at the SpaceX construction site on Friday. It shows Starship serial number 10 and 11 inside in different assembly states. Serial number 11 has just begun assembly and serial number 10 is almost ready for a nose cone stack. One thing that's different about Starship serial number 10 already is the top just above the forward dome. Where on previous Starship prototypes the hull of the tank section ended just above the top dome, serial number 10 does things different. The hull is still growing and is now two rings higher than normal. This could have multiple reasons. Changed plumbing for higher flights, better nose cone integration, sturdier construction. There's bracing visible in the new rings, so it's a strengthened part of the hull. Next to it, the giant 80-meter high bay is nearing completion. There still is no sign of Elon Musk's mentioned 360-degree glass viewing lounge though. Will it be inside or on the outside? I'm eager to hear your thoughts. As always, tell me in the comments. Looking at the high bay from another angle reveals the inside. Besides the two construction jigs on the ground, presumably for super heavy construction, we can see that Starship serial number 9 has got a new home and aft fins. It's likely the backup for Starship serial number 8. A second chance, so to say, if Starship serial number 8 does not do the trick and craters somewhere near the launch site. SpaceX will, if no infrastructure gets damaged, immediately be able to continue testing this way. Learning from mistakes and trying again. It's a good indicator for how high the failure chance of serial number 8 is rated internally at SpaceX. High. It's to be expected though. Again, nothing remotely comparable to a Starship has ever flown. There are lots of ways this could go wrong. There's one more interesting part on the main plaza right in front of one of the large manufacturing tents. It's a nose cone skirt, presumably for Starship serial number 9. From the bird's eye view, the inside is revealed, and it shows COPVs. These black tanks are used to power turbopump spin-up and reaction control thrusters. Before Starship serial number 8, these tanks were located on the outside of the prototype. For higher altitude flights, these tanks have to be moved to the inside for aerodynamic reasons. SpaceX has moved a few of them inside the engine skirt, and as seen here, few have been moved into the fairing skirt as well. Boca Chica, Texas is in the final phase before the Starship serial number 8 flight right now. And the hammering question on everyone's mind right now, of course, must be when its first real Starship flight will be. So let's try to narrow it down at least, as there still is no official information out there. All this is just an educated guess, of course, but we have a few clues already. So we have test dates set from today all the way to Friday right now. All from 9 a.m. to 9 p.m. local time, with the exception of the backup date on Friday, which is from 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. And that's not a good time window for a flight. Short and starting early in the morning. So my idea right now is that SpaceX will use this week for final tests, static fires, final checks and data analysis. Then, on November 14th, we have the launch of Crew 1 from Kennedy Space Center. SpaceX's first regular crewed launch to the ISS. This is very important, and I am pretty sure that Elon Musk will not want to miss it or have it overshadowed by a cratering Starship in Texas at the same time. So if all this is correct, the Starship flight cannot be seen yet on the test dates list. It's likely to be next week, if nothing unforeseen happens. November 16th to 22nd. Will we finally see the Starship take flight? Starship is something completely new, something that's never been there before. Sometimes it's hard to try new things. We don't want to change, we like it the way it was, right? Today's sponsor though was able to convince me to try something and embrace change. Today's episode is brought to you by the Ridge Wallet. It's light, sleek and industrial, it doesn't fold or awkwardly bulge in your pocket, and it seriously changed my whole pocket situation. So much for the official message. Ridge asked me to try out their wallet for free, and if I'd like it, to show to you what I like the most. I gave it a try. That was 8 weeks ago. I'm one of those habit people when it comes to my wallet. I don't change stuff. I took everything out of the old wallet and carried the Ridge wallet around every day. It holds up to 12 cards plus room for cash. There's over 30 colors and styles, including carbon fiber and burnt titanium. It has 30,000 five-star reviews. It's so durable, it comes with a lifetime warranty. You can buy it and carry it for the rest of your life, and the Ridge team is so confident that you'll like it that they'll let you test drive it for 45 days. You can send it back for a full refund if you don't love it. And frankly, after giving it a try for 2 months, I know why. There was so much stuff in my old wallet and I thought I had to have all of it with me all the time. When I changed to the Ridge wallet, I thought the space would never be enough. I was wrong. One of my rules for sponsoring is to only advertise for products that I personally like. This is one of them. I'll never return back to my old wallet ever again. To make the most awesome wallet switch of your life and at the same time support What About It, go to rich.com/felix, that's rich.com/felix, and use the code Felix to get 10% off today with free worldwide shipping and returns. Change your pocket situation with Rich, links in the description. Today's Patreon and YouTube member shoutout goes to Eirik Goa, Matthew Marchand, Lucky Green and Miha Jerson. You rock! Welcome to the Y family. If you want to be part of the Discord community, chat with me and others on the voice channels, or even be part of the team that helps create What About It twice a week, consider becoming a patron or a YouTube member by clicking on the link in the description or the join button right under this video. Thank you. And the last words, as always, go out to my team, relentlessly working behind the scenes to keep everything going and to improve the show where I couldn't. They're pitching in ideas, doing quality control, managing the community, and creating captions for every episode for you. They are the unsung heroes, and that's why I mention them every time. Thank you for being part of my journey. You rock! Static fires, final checks, and the cat is jumping around. Streaming cat. Internal work is progressing more. Progressing? What the hell? Looking at the launch site from this perspective, internal work is progressing more and more. God damn it, I love this word. Give me a second. Joe from RGV took some very interesting pictures on his last flight that I'd like to show you today. Come in and find out. Give me a second, Alex. I just gotta relax my speaking muscle. Maybe.